So a while back, I broke the onboard parallel port on this old 386 system. Basically, it was because I swapped the parallel cable while the system was still running. I heard a pop, and ever since then, I've not been able to get data across the parallel or serial port on the system. That's a bummer because having those ports on board saved needing to use one of the expansion slots for I/O. And as you can see, this is a slim desktop that uses a vertical riser for its expansion. So it only has 5 slots available. But luckily, it seems those are the only things that got damaged on this system. So I've added a serial card that has a parallel and serial port, but I'd like to have a second serial port on this system. And many I/O cards have a header to support that. But I also wanted to see if upgrading from an 8250 UART to a 16550 actually would make a difference. This particular I/O card has a socket to support doing just that. So in this video, I'll show a before and after result on that kind of upgrade on an old 386DX. So on the backside here, I covered up the onboard parallel port to remind myself that it doesn't work anymore. The onboard serial port also didn't work reliably, so I disabled those also. On these old systems, the ports are disabled using jumpers. So to test the serial I/O, I do that by transferring a file between two systems. In this case, I use the jungle.dat file that is about 3 megabytes. It's a file that's part of the Jungle Strike game from 1993. I remember renting this game for the Sega Genesis at Blockbuster. It was a follow-up to Desert Strike, and both were great games at the time. And they're available on the PC also. Anyway, so this system is using MS-DOS 5, and I'm setting up a terminal program called Connect to do the transfer. Then on my modern laptop, I set up a program, Zoc, as the receiver, setting both at 115/200 baud. I press a few keys to test the terminal connection, and everything looks stable. Alright, now I tell Connect program to upload the test file. And there it goes. After a few moments, the rate seems to settle on a throughput of about 2.6 to 2.8 kilobytes per second using a regular Z modem protocol. I'll repeat the Z modem test again after we add in the new UART chip. So let's get to it. First, get this power supply out of the way. I've already removed the screws, so this is just a visual of how things are normally arranged. Then flip this secondary CF card out of the way. I keep this paper here just as an extra divider between the cards. Gravity pulls these horizontal cards down, so it's just an extra precaution here to keep the board separated. Now to remove the serial I/O card. It's a regular 8-bit ISA multi-I/O card from around 1988 that also has a real-time clock, but I've never even removed the paper to activate the battery. I still have the manuals, so let me show what I found in there. Okay, for a secondary serial port, it says there are a few chips that have to be installed. I've always read that the 16550 can be a direct replacement to an 8250. And the 188 and 189 here are voltage level shifters to support the RS-232. The board itself doesn't really have these labels U1, U2, U4, but earlier in the manual it has this diagram that shows what area those are located at. So having found all that, I went to mouser.com and ordered the chips. The primary 8250 on this card is soldered in, but the secondary one is socketed. If you haven't handled chips like these, it's probably not obvious which way they go, and that is important. A good rule of thumb is to match the orientation of all the other chips on the board. So when you go in to actually install new chips, you'll find that the pins are angled out like this. They have various tools to pull the pins in, but what I use is a credit card. And no, I don't mean I pay someone else to do it. What I mean is I place one side of the pins into a socket, then I use a hard plastic edge of a card to gently press in on the other side. Be patient and gentle, go slow, because you don't want to bend these pins. Then before you press the chip down, double check both sides to see that everything looks reasonably lined up. Then press it down, and again make sure none of the pins have bent out of place. If it looked right, then you might need a chip puller like this and try again, or some small flat spade to pry the chip out. The larger 16550 chip is the same idea. This triple check on those pin alignments before pressing it down in. Now we need to attach a connector to the 9-pin header on the I.O. card. Again, the manual explains where that is located. There are various cable options for this. Generally, a red or blue wire marks which one is wire 1 or pin 1. Now let's reinstall this card. And yes, I'm dangling both the joystick port and serial port out the back of the case. I recall that the joystick port on the sound card had a conflict, and I couldn't see a way to disable the joystick port on this serial card. The Sound Blaster supported a jumper to disable its joystick port, so I just did that, just to keep one joystick port active. Now for this dangling serial port, did you know the original NEC PC8001 from 1979? You had to tether into its serial port similar like this, with the cable oozing out the back of the system. I did another video about that a while back. Alright, well, on startup, the BIOS is now showing two serial ports, so that's a good sign. Okay, now we have to adjust the connect program to use COM2, since that's the one that has a 16550 UART. Then I do a key press test to show the data is correctly being exchanged at this baud rate across both systems. That all looks good. Now to upload the test file again. There it goes. Give it a few minutes to collect some transfer metrics. And it looks like we're getting about 4.9 kilobytes a second with Z-modem. So that's an improvement over the 2.6 kilobytes a second we were getting earlier. Main thing for me is that I now have two working serial ports, so now I can use the mouse and do serial communication at the same time. So in particular, now I can do this. I can play the original Warcraft across a null modem cable. You probably noticed I have an HP protocol analyzer in between these two systems, so you can see the serial communication going on. I set the game to use the lowest speed option it had, 2400 baud, to make it easier to see the traffic in real time. Here you can see one client is sending a waiting message in regular ASCII as it waits for the other client to join the session. Then as they connect to each other, all kinds of crazy data traffic happens to keep both sides in sync about the current game state. That's all for this video. Thank you for watching. Your command.